Hello and welcome back. Today I want to talk about thermal measurements performed on electronic circuits, and in particular how a thermal imaging camera can help in this process. Today's video is sponsored by Hikmicro, a thermal imaging equipment and solutions provider. I will be using one of their products, the B1L handheld thermal camera, to perform today's measurements. More information on this product will be available at the end of the video. So, how do you perform a very accurate temperature measurement? Well, the most common way used in electronics development is by direct contact measurement using thermocouples or RTDs. So, these contact sensors are, well, put in contact with the hot component that you wish to measure, and using some processing equipment like a data logger, you can measure multiple temperature spots on a PCB. This can offer very accurate measurements as low as 0.1 degrees Celsius, but the big limitation is the number of actual points that you can realistically measure. So with a small PCB that only has like 5 components, you can easily measure every single one of them. But with a high density complex board, there are so many potential points to verify that it quickly becomes unreasonable to measure every single one of them. So what do you do? How do you choose where to measure? Well, this is where infrared thermography comes into play. This offers a non-contact measurement method that allows you to make quick temperature measurements and scan a wide area in a really quick fashion. So, to perform this recording, I've connected the Hikmicro using the USB to the computer, and I'm recording the video there, so the data can be later analyzed. So this way we can scan large areas and quickly identify any points of interest. So, for example, this component right here, which seems to be quite warm. But there's a catch. Infrared imaging will be accurate and give good information only if done correctly. So for this, first of all, you need to understand how thermography works and what measures need to be taken in order to get the best possible results. So an infrared camera works by measuring the light intensity in the infrared spectrum coming from an object, this light intensity being proportional to the object's temperature. But it's important to observe though that not all of the light that the camera picks up is actually coming from the object to which it's pointed at. So the light that reaches the camera is a combination of three main sources. So on the one side you got the light that is actually emitted by the object. Depending on the object's nature, you might have some light that's being transmitted through it, so from somewhere in the background. And finally, you have light that's being reflected off the object, so from somewhere in the environment. And from all three of these, the only light that's actually coming from the object is the one emitted. So to measure how well a surface emits its own infrared light, we have the emissivity coefficient. So this is a coefficient that expresses how efficiently a surface is emitting its own light. On the one hand, if you have an emissivity coefficient closer to 1, almost all of the light coming from the object is actually generated by the object. So for example, things like human skin or maybe the rough matte surface of an IC. But on the other hand, closer to 0, we have objects that mostly transmit or reflect light. So some objects will behave more like a piece of transparent glass or like a mirror. So when looking at the complex board, we get both extremes and everything in between. If we look at this board, we have things like this IC that has a very matte surface, so we can get a reasonably accurate measurement on it. But then we also have surfaces like these metallic parts, so this heat pipe and the various shielding elements. So although these look extremely cold, that's only because we're seeing the reflected temperature rather than the emitted temperature. So these are elements that have very low emissivities, and well, depending on how I wave my hand around, we're seeing the temperature of my hand rather than the temperature that's present on the component on the board. So this is a mainly reflective surface, whereas this other is a mainly emissive surface. Now, you either know all of the emissivity coefficients of the various surfaces which is not that easy to do, or you try to change the surface properties. So one common way is by applying materials with known emissivity coefficients like electrical tape, or just painting everything with a thin layer of non-conductive paint, which again has a known emissivity coefficient. But if you don't want to do that, at least be aware that the emissivity factor can induce some really large errors if not correctly taken into account. So an infrared measurement made without a strict control of the analyzed surface and the surrounding environment can lead to false results. Now, other than the light coming from the object, which is a combination of the reflected, transmitted, and emitted light, we also have an impact from the atmosphere. So in the infrared spectrum, the atmosphere isn't perfectly transparent. So based on the atmosphere's temperature and humidity, the light coming from the object will be affected by this. So to make the most accurate measurement possible, the atmospheric properties also need to be taken into account. And setting all of these parameters can be done in post-processing software. For this, Hikmicro offers the Hikmicro Analyzer software. So with this, you can post-process your thermal images and set things like global environment temperature and humidity, as well as for each of the analyzed points, you can set individual emissivity values, distance from which they were measured, and what temperature is being reflected by those surfaces. So after you've taken all of your infrared captures, you can edit them at a later time and thus obtain your best possible measurement results. So why even bother with the thermocouples? Why not make the infrared measurement the only thing that you perform on your circuit? Well, even if all of the settings are done correctly or of the environmental parameters are controlled and known, you will still typically get the 1 to 2 degrees Celsius measurement error for uncooled infrared sensors. So is it even worth bothering then? Well, of course. So what I have here is a commercial power supply. It's a flyback that's outputting 12 volts. And right now I have it connected to an active load supplying 600 milliamps. So if I want to check the components on this, how much they heat up, which components should I choose? I mean, I could go for the rectifying diodes, or maybe the power transformer, or the switch. So if we have an overall look at the power supply, well, we can see our diodes here are really warm. We can see the transformer, well, it's not that hot. But the hottest components are, well, this resistor and this resistor and, well, these other two resistors. So honestly, I don't know what the purpose of those components is, but those seem to be the hottest components on the board. So even if different components have different temperature limits, these particular components also need to be taken into account, not just the main switching converter elements. So it's very easy to focus on the complex parts of a circuit and simply forget about everything else. But with the infrared camera, you can always identify all of your points of interest. Now, other than identifying the hotspots on a board, the infrared camera can be really helpful to pinpoint where exactly to put your thermocouple. So knowing which component is hot is not enough. It's important to observe that the surface of a component does not have a uniform temperature, and its hottest part is not necessarily in the center, if the component even has an obvious center. So what I have here is the backside of a laptop, where one of the identified hotspots is this IC. So we can quickly confirm it using the infrared camera. We can see that this IC right here is one of the hottest components on the board. So we can proceed to measure it with a thermocouple. But where exactly should we put it? I mean, this is a large 3x3 centimeter IC. Does it really matter where we put the thermocouple? Well, to get a better idea on what sort of influence the position of the thermocouple can have, I prepared this little adapter thingy. So this is built with an infrared transparent lens. So it's a zinc selenium lens. So this is commonly used for things like CO2 lasers. And we can simply clip this onto the infrared camera, and what this will do, it will allow us to focus from very small distances. So now if we look at our IC, so let me take a couple captures, we might notice a few interesting details. So let's look at this on the computer now. So in this picture, we can clearly see the outline of the silicon chip. We can see this pin 1 key, and we can see that in the middle we have the actual silicon in the chip. And we can also see, maybe not clearly at the moment, that this upper area is a bit warmer than everything else. So now, let's play around with the settings a bit. Maybe change the color palette. So we're not really interested in temperatures below 49, we're only interested in the hotspot. And if I go over it with my mouse, we can see that our maximum temperature is about 66.4, so right here in this hotspot, whereas on the rest of the die we get to below 60, so 60, 59, and so on. So based on where exactly the thermocouple is placed in the die area, we will get about a 6 degree temperature difference. And of course, if we miss the die altogether and we go over the rest of the package, we can go as low as 51 degrees. So based on the exact position in which you put your thermocouple in, you can get completely different results for the same exact component. In the end, the most accurate temperature measurements are done with context sensors, but a very accurate sensor is not really useful if you don't know where to put it. So an infrared camera can be quite helpful since it can scan a very large area really quickly and pinpoint not just the components that need to be analyzed, but also identify where exactly on the critical components you need to measure them, since their surface is usually not uniformly heated. The Hikmicro B1L camera is an infrared camera that has a fast image frequency of 25 Hz. Combined with a 160 by 120 pixel sensor, you get a high image quality that you can clearly see on its 3.2 inch color LCD. Or you can see it on a different device using its Wi-Fi connectivity. Other interesting aspects are its high temperature alarm feature and its front side LED work light, as well as an 8-hour long battery life. So, hope you got some useful information out of this. Leave your thoughts in the comments. Thank you for watching and see you next time. Bye bye.